This is the introduction to Apache Kafka on producers. So for producers, let's get outside of the Kafka cluster proper, those brokers that are doing all the replication, partition management, all the stuff that they do, outside of those and think about the applications that use Kafka. This could be code that you write. Producers are the client applications that write into a cluster. And every component of the Kafka platform that's not a broker is, at the end of the day, either a producer or a consumer or both. This is everything that interacts with Kafka. It's either going to put stuff in or get stuff out, or both. Producers are how we get stuff in. So let's take a look at them. Now, the API surface area of the producer library is really pretty simple. I'm going to show you a little bit of Java code. If you're not a Java person, don't worry. There's official support from a Confluent perspective of Python, Go, JavaScript, languages of the .NET platform, community-based drivers for really any language you could think of. If you find one that's not supported, I want to know about it because it's probably something pretty cool. And Java is, of course, the native language of Kafka. Features show up in the Java library first, and it's the one that I'll be using in this module and the next. So here's our first producer. It's a thermostat app reading from a smart thermostat, and there is a class conveniently called Kafka Producer that we're going to use. That's going to connect to the cluster in our application. That's an API that we would write code against, and it handles all of the network plumbing and getting messages in and making sure they're acknowledged and the trade-offs between, you know, low latency and good throughput, batching, all of these things configurable in the producer. So for those configuration parameters, you give the producer class a map of parameters of key value pairs. We're doing that with a properties file here. You see down at the bottom, that's got the bootstrap servers and the acts equal to all stuff down there. The bootstrap servers list is pointing the producer to the cluster. So that's a list of some of the brokers in the cluster, two or three, right? Now, the cluster could have 50 brokers in it. I don't know. Maybe it's huge. You don't want to list all of those, right? Because some of them come and go, and, you know, do you really want names? And that's a lot. So if you just list a few of them, that gives it a chance that it can connect to at least one of them. So like if the first one is down, but the second one's up, that's fine. It's got one connection. It gets all the metadata back from that broker about the cluster that it needs. And now the producer, in this case, in general, the client library, knows what it needs to know about the cluster. It can build connection pools and manage all the network stuff appropriately. Security would be another thing that would show up in there typically. So this is a very, very clean, nice, pretty example with only two properties. Usually there's, you know, maybe 5 or 10 in a practical case. But to produce, we create that Kafka producer object. And then another class we need is called producer record. That's what you use to hold the key value pair that you want to send to the cluster. So messages, these events, these are key value pairs, and so producer record is the class that we use to create one. It also needs to know the topic that we're sending that message to. That's a part of that producer record. There's more that you could do there. You can have precise control over the timestamp that's defined, the partition it gets written to if you're into that kind of thing, headers, you can define those key value pair headers in there. But essentially, this is the core API surface area that you absolutely need to think about how to produce messages. And given the rest of the network plumbing, as I say, going on under there, and acknowledging messages, retransmitting, dealing with enforced item potency, all kinds of things that can be happening, this isn't really trivial code. It seems like it's a simple thing because the API is so simple, but whether you know it or not, you are very glad that someone else wrote this library for you. And a quick note about the code you just saw. You may have noticed I had created an object and then just kind of serialized it into JSON and dumped it in as a string. And that's a little sloppy. As I said earlier in the course, Kafka is agnostic with respect to data format. The key and the value are just bytes. That's all it really knows on the inside. But here at the producer level, you might care, right? You've got some kind of domain object that uses your language's type system. Now, Kafka has built-in serializers for primitive types, things like integer, long, double, string. And we made this JSON just a string, so Kafka thought it was just dealing with a string. But usually, you want something that's going to relate to the actual format of your object, the schema that you've got in use. Not showing that right now. We do have a module coming up in a little bit on the Confluent Schema Registry where we can talk about how that works and a slightly more sophisticated approach to serialization and deserialization there. A little bit earlier, we were talking about partitions, and I said, you know, when you're writing, you have to decide what partition. We talked about hashing and round robining and all of that. Well, it's the producer library that makes that decision, that does that hashing and decides on the partition to send the message to. So that's another little thing that's being done by this code in the producer. And that really is your introduction to the Kafka producer. This might be a place where you start to get your hands dirty with some code. At some point, you're gonna need to get your fingers on the keyboard. If you are a developer watching this, really see how the API works, type things out for yourself, watch them run. That's important. But next up, we're gonna look at the other half of producing, consuming.